till början av 80-talet, för det var nämligen då den hårda rocken blev hård på riktigt.
You know, we learned from Iron Maiden and Motorhead and Judas Priest and bands like that. So of course it's natural to take it a step further and you put a little twist on it, and we just played fast.
We liked, you know, a lot of the new wave of British metal, and we loved punk too. We put those two together and kind of developed a style, and growing up in LA and the glam scene really helped inspire us playing faster and louder, you know. Seeing all of this other stuff made us just disgusted, and we wanted your attention. So the louder we played, the faster we played, thinking the most, you know, we get more attention with that. You know, there were bands that were doing lots of fast stuff, underground punk stuff. But you know, I guess my first time of noticing how punk and metal came together okay was going to a Motorhead show and seeing that, whoa, that dude's got a purple mohawk, you know? And he's here, and he's not getting beat up, and you know, no one cares. He's there for the music, you know? When was it? Lars and I and Ron McGovney went to go see them, yeah, in Hollywood somewhere. When was it? It was probably 81, 80 or 81.
Thought I had never had a plan. And if we did, it went wrong, you know. Always. No, I mean, we just played these songs and they got faster as we played them, you know, and faster again. And then we were doing slow songs and they were pretty fast too, you know. So just, I don't know, we just played that way.
I remember first time I heard a band like Discharge. We had like a tape with Venom and Discharge on it, me and my brother, and we listened to it, and we're like, this is it. It sounds like a, I don't know, like an airplane landing, you know, in your head or something like that. And after that, we're like, we gotta play fast.
People kept saying at the time, oh, Venom is the new Motorhead, you know, and all that. So I said, okay, we'll go and have a look. And he was doing a bass solo, and it's the worst fucking mess I ever heard in my life. It's fucking atrocious, you know. But I think that was their attraction, you know, that they were so bad, you know.
It had this punk rock attitude. It had this feel to it where you didn't have to be a perfect musician. You know, all these Yngwie Malmsteens and all these bands that were good musicians, we got into that, but we knew that we could never do it with our abilities. We're not as good. So we took the music into extremes, you know, like Venom. They had this spirit, they had this kind of vibe to it where you can just go out and do things.
You just got to figure, around that time, 81, 82, 83, you have a whole generation of people, 16, 17, 18 years old, like us, that were all listening to this kind of music all around the world, and then picking up guitars and starting our own bands.
Trots att det var ett globalt fenomen det här med hårdrock, så var det i Amerika som sammansmältningen av punken och hårdrocken lyckades bäst. Kanske för att det sociala klimatet i Amerika, den engelska punken och det inhemska arvet skapat hardcore, en stil som även den påverkade metalscenen.
You couldn't go down to like the hardcore punk clubs with long hair and a leather jacket.
You get beat up.
You get your ass kicked.
And that whole time in 84 and 85 when we actually did start going to the hardcore shows and going to see bands like Agnostic Front in New York and becoming then friends with a lot of people in that scene. And then those guys coming to our shows in New York and moshing and stage diving. And I could say, I mean, I could pretty much say that we were the first metal band in New York, in the East Coast, where we were having pits and stuff at our shows because it was our friends from CBGBs who were coming to the shows and doing that.
Stage diving.
And then you get all the metal kids like,
what's that?
That looks like fun. And that's how it started. And I remember we played the Ritz in like early 85 and like all our friends from CBGBs were down there. We put like 60 people on the guest list and they were going nuts. And that was, it was this huge, like then from that point on, it was like, you know, the mosh thing just, it took off.
For us, it was normal, you know? That's why the influence was there. When we toured the States, it was always normal that we had at least 30% of hardcore kids at the shows, you know? It was just normal that the hardcore kids would appreciate metal, extreme metal, as much as they would like the hardcore stuff.
A lot of those bands probably looked to bands like us and or Metallica, those type of bands, and said, you know what, we can do it with jeans and a t-shirt. We don't need to puff our hair up. We could be more street. And I think people were ready to accept that because they were sick of the whole glitz and glam stuff.
I was like Motley Crue. I thought they were good because they were like just as badass, and more badass than a lot of them heavy bands. You know, it's just that they looked like girls. You know, half the time.
We understood that LA wasn't the place for us. Moving up to San Francisco and getting a good response, getting people that were there for the music and for just more of the aggression or the more of the feelings of music, not just going to hang out and drink. And other bands were starting to emerge around that time. Exodus especially, there was a band that we were doing lots of gigs with.
Let's go.
you look at those Metal Massacre albums that Brian Slagle put out, you could see the history on those of what bands emerged, you know, in LA too. They started coming out, Armored Saint, Bitch, and all of these things. Like, the new wave of British metal had hit the West Coast, you know.
Metalscenen med fäste i San Franciscos Bay Area blomstrade snart och musiken spreds över världen. Kassetter byttes och fanzin startades och för många musiker var ännu en pusselbit på plats.
A lot of different bands start to show up like through fanzines and really like underground tape trading and stuff like that. Bands like Venom and Hellhammer back in like 84, 85. And then Metallica, all those bands. It was really cool because we had to search for music. We didn't really had like MTV or anybody telling us, you know, how to dress or how to listen to our music. We had to search for it, and we find different people in different places that like the same style of music, and we start exchanging music. That was very important at the time.
We had a list of stuff that we could trade with other people, and most of those people had their own band. So we had our own band as well, and we didn't have a tape. So we recorded the demo. That was the reason why we recorded the End of the World demo, to have something to give back to the people that we wrote to. And it wasn't necessarily meant to get us a record deal, because we didn't think about these things, you know? So it was definitely, in the mid-80s, that was a big, big thing. You know, the Sepultura guys, that's how I, you know, they wrote me, and they sent me the tapes, and it was amazing. You know, we knew a band from Brazil.
Way more into like death metal in the beginning of the band, and then we start listening to bands, especially bands like Exodus and Testament and bands like that, who were more like what they were calling like thrash metal, for especially from that area, the Bay Area. A lot of those bands were influencing us.
You know, it was an awesome time. All those bands coming up and just, you know, we put shows together Monday nights, and just, you know, I just remember, you know, we'd go up on the hill and just drink and blast Venom and Tank and all the stuff we loved. It was a family.
Just in our field, there was like what they used to say, like the four bands, was us, Metallica, Slayer, Megadeth. And then other bands spawned after that. But for the time, you know, with us, it was like, this was thrash metal. This is what people came to, you know, they liked it. They came to buy our records. And then other bands took notice of it and said, hey, we can be thrash metal too, why not? And then that happened. And then after that whole thrash metal explosion, you had so many other forms of music that happened after that, I believe, that, you know, you flood the market.
Charlie Supply!
But then at the time in, let's say, 88, 89, all the bands that were playing fast and aggressive music or, you know, whatever, got signed right away without having a tape, you know? And it was very easy for some bands to get a record deal. So that's what destroyed a whole lot of the scene back then, because the industry just jumped on it and kind of squeezed it.
In the late 80s, when the scene really did start to change, because basically the hair bands came along and it kind of, in a way, destroyed a lot of what was so cool about metal, because people then considered that to be metal and that was just fucking lame.
It all spawned different things, you know, power metal, traditional metal in Germany, it's like, you know, Viking metal.
Yeah, there's always going to be, you know, there'll always be some type of underground, there'll always be whatever's considered to be the most extreme. You know, you've got so many, from when we started even, you know, you go back to when we first started playing and, you know, you had a band like Venom, and then after that you had Hellhammer / Celtic Frost, and then say Slayer, who, you know, that was kind of the transition, those bands that definitely started the more extreme side of things. I mean, I think if you talk to any black metal band or death metal band since the late 80s, they would tell you, well, that's the first thing they were, you know. Dead, your God is dead. Wolf, your God is dead. Your flesh, brands of light. Behold, Satan's rise. Curse of priest. The feeble church.
Många av de stora metalbanden utvecklades i takt med att intresset för dem minskade. Resultatet blev i flera fall att mer marknadsanpassade album släpptes i början av 90-talet. Men fanan för den hårda musiken bars vidare. Många bra band fortsatte helt enkelt att släppa bra skivor. Samtidigt uteblev den stora publiken till förmån för en helt annan typ av musik.